Hey, everybody. Welcome back. Oh, my gosh. If you are listening to this episode, I am super beyond excited because I connected with this new friend of mine on the Pod Booker website. And I got to give a shout out to that. If you're in the podcast community and you are looking to connect to either be a guest, if you want to be a guest on someone's podcast or you host a podcast, you got to check out Pod Booker. I am not getting paid for this plug. I happened to meet the owner, the creator of it, Daniel Geffen, a while back, and he's just doing an incredible thing. And this is where I met Eric Patrick Thomas, a.k.a. Mr. Inspire, who's hanging out with us all the way from Flint, Michigan. He is an entrepreneur who is passionate about changing the way people view disabilities. He is a hip-hop artist. He is a founder of the Inspire brand clothing line. He's also the owner of Easy Awareness by Design, which is doing graphic design for custom apparel for all types of people, including those with disabilities. And he is an advocate for all of these incredible things. He's spoken for the House and Senate hearings. He's on several boards. This guy is just really taking something that has been a challenging situation and really leading the way to inspire everybody he meets. So Eric, I am beyond honored to be spending some time with you today.
Hey, thanks for having me. It was like the dramatic voice is just like, what an introduction. I feel like I'm in a movie trailer.
Go figure. Like, I never knew until like 2 years ago, right? So I just dropped episode 80 and I have a whole bunch in the woodwork that's like, you know, still either being edited or haven't been released yet. And I'm realizing like how comfortable I am now at episode whatever that this is, over 100 that's been recorded versus like 1 and 2. And one of the things about me that's like some people know, and I've talked about it in previous episodes, is I'm not a public speaker by default. This is a learned attribute, right? I'm shy and I'm an introvert, and you know, being a therapist, I have to talk to people. But I joke that like, when do I have to turn on my podcast voice? You know, so thanks for being playful with that.
But he flips the voice on the podcast voice. Good afternoon and welcome. Yeah.
So we're gonna have some fun today, you and me. So yes. I want to go back, right? Because I think everything that we're gonna talk about goes back to the thing that changed life for you.
Yeah.
So give us a quick, what was life? Because I know we're kind of leading to a cliffhanger, and obviously by what we've already talked about, people know the category we're going into, but not knowing your engagement with that community, what was life like before that fateful night for you, and what was going on in your world until that evening in 1997?
But that day, I mean, I was going to photography college. So I just came back from Chicago, like in July, to look at internships. But I also had my group Miscellaneous. Mm-hmm. So we were also recording all the time, performing. And so I don't know the direction that was going to go. But I always, you know, made sure that I kind of didn't put everything into one basket, I guess you would say. I was also working two jobs. I was working a marketing job, and I was working at Myers. I guess that would be like your supermarket grocery mm-hmm. store chain that's up here. Well, it's kind of like in the mid-east. You know, it's not just in Michigan anymore. So that's kind of what I was doing. You know, like I didn't even have time to watch. I had a TV, but I never watched it. You know, I didn't have time to do that stuff.
Yeah, you were busy.
I was 20 years old. We had a lot of parties at the house. I actually had a house DJ, DJ Who. So if you came over to visit sometimes, there would just be a DJ playing, you know, like, hey, welcome to Eric's house, or welcome to the Miscellaneous house. What, can I get any requests and stuff? And you know what I mean? It was a house DJ.
Yeah.
And then it was just, that's what was going on. We were happy, and it was a good moment that was happening. You know, I was doing good. I was just trying to figure life out, you know? And then that night was September 20th is when September 19th was the celebration on the flyer, but it didn't start until after 12 a.m. So how it became September 19th, that didn't make any sense. But so, and there's no MySpace or Facebook or any of this stuff. There's barely internet. People are on the internet.
Right. There was AOL. You know, that was it. Yeah. That was the thing.
The dialogue. Yep. Yeah. And there was pagers, you know. And so, we were getting ready for the night, and then we actually went to a coffee shop, and there was a freestyle competition, like a cypher. And we got into that. That was pretty fun. But Big Perm was still bouncing at the other club. So we had to go pick him up. And then we just all came back to the house and it was just happy moment. But there were people there that I didn't know. There was people there that I didn't know. And I usually do not go outside. I'm always inside the house. And I was just sitting on the steps and I was talking to my girlfriend at the time. And then in mid-conversation, I just stood up and walked down the steps in the house and walked outside. And it was like I was being pulled out there. It was really weird. Like I never go outside. And I was out there for maybe 5 minutes, just making sure that like nobody was in my neighbor's yards and stuff. Everything was cool. And then she was on the steps or at the top of the steps. And I was going to go back in the house and I was talking to her. And then the DJ van was behind me. And then someone pulled a gun. They pulled the gun and pow, 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 pow. You know, and that's like when your instinct of what your reflex, you look towards the direction that the sound is coming from. So they shot me from the left side of my backside. So I instantly looked like that. And I think that's how the bullet just got into the neck and went into the third vertebrae, paralyzed me instantly. I mean, it's between the third and fourth vertebrae. And then there's like a piece of skin on the back of my skull that looks like where one might have grazed, like maybe when I turned or something. And then I dropped to the ground and then I wasn't able to move anything. But at that time, I wasn't able to think about moving anything either. You know, it was just like I was laying there just like in this like wave of numbness. And then I wasn't able to breathe on my own too. But I'm not able to even figure out how to breathe. You know, I'm just there. I'm existing, I guess. And I could see up in the sky, but I was in and out, but it was dark. And then I could hear people screaming. And then I could hear, you know, someone's been shot, Eric's been shot. And I was like, then my mind was like, oh, like, how did this happen? Like, already? Like, I felt unfinished. I felt like I had so much more to accomplish. And I felt like this isn't over yet. This can't be this, you know, things like that. And I was just like, it's got to be more, whatever it is, you know, I want to live. I don't want to check out yet, you know, or something. It was really, you know, it didn't feel done. Like life wasn't done. So I never questioned that I wasn't not going to survive. I just didn't know what any of the circumstances were.
Yeah.
Before you know it, I'm in the hospital, you know, they're drilling screws in my head because I had to get a halo. So now my head's like in this metal bird cage, you know, with the screws in my forehead and the screws above my ears. And then they intubate me. So they put the tube down my throat. And then I wake up in the morning, see my mom, stepdad, dad, stepmom, medical and friends. And then they tell you what happened, of course, again. And then that's when you find out you're not able to move from the neck down. But survival is really on your mind. You know, you're not, everything's happening, but you're not able to really think about the thoughts of like, I'm not able to move my arm. I'm not able to move my legs. I'm not able to get up. What's going on? I'm freaking out. But you're like more like I need to survive, like survival. And then I'm not able to communicate either with my mouth. I communicated with eye blinks, and then it was just like I didn't go to sleep, but I couldn't sleep. I was not able to sleep. They put Ativan, I think, in my IV. Once they did that, I think that's for like calming you down, and then you fall out. Nobody knew who did this. Well, people didn't know who did the shooting. People thought that they knew who did the shooting. So everybody was coming with all these stories, and it was this person did it, and this person, you know, and it was just like, it just kept up bringing up more emotions and stuff. And I was under an alias too. So there were people that were trying to come see me, but I didn't know their real name. I just knew their nickname that I always called them by. And they were, so that caused frustration and confusion. You know, my parents didn't, there was a lot of people that they've never met that I've been hanging out with for a year or so, you know, so it's a lot of emotions. And then of course, a couple of weeks later, that's when they say you'll be paralyzed from the rest of your life and you're not going to breathe on your own forever. So that's when they decided to take the tubes out of my throat or out of my mouth and then give me a tracheotomy and put them in my throat. And that's when I was able to actually move my mouth and communicate with my tongue clicks. And I was able to eat again because I was able to eat for those other times. Yeah. When I got to eat for the first time, woo, happy moments, man.
So what was that time frame from that night to you being able to start getting that to happen for you to start being able to speak again?
I want to say like 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
I want to say like 2.5, 3 weeks. Like, I mean, don't, if I say it wrong, you know.
Right. But that's what it, at least it felt
that's
like.
What it, yeah, that's what I feel like. I'm sure if my mom listens to the podcast, she'll be like, Erica, you know it was 3.5 weeks. I'm like, okay, yeah. I know. Okay, I'll remember that. Then I got to go correct all the other ones.
In this mindset, so you're sitting there, you can't move. Like the first thing I'm thinking of is like, you know, that people when they wake up sometimes and they have what they call sleep paralysis, where your body hasn't caught up with your mind and your mind hasn't caught up with your body, that you know you're awake, but your body, right? And some people have that for a few seconds. Some people might have, there's a medical condition. What was that thoughts where you, right, where you had this thought thinking and it wasn't like, you know, the best metaphor playfully that I could say is like go, go, gadget arms, right? And nothing was going, right? What was that like? Because I know you said, right, you needed an Ativan to calm down. Like, what was it like to have that feeling of, I know this is working. I know my brain is working. I know my thoughts are working. I know I'm alive, but I feel like there's literally a cognitive disconnect between what I'm thinking and what I'm now doing or not doing. What was that like?
Well, like even right now when I'm trying to move my arms or legs, like the mind is going in and it almost is like you have like this second body inside you that's moving. Now, if I say like if I'm trying to concentrate and raise my arm right now, the second body is right heavy. So now there's weight. The legs are weighted. The arms are weighted. So when I do this, it doesn't feel like the second body is up raising its arm. It feels like it's right there struggling to lift the arm like a weight. You know, I'm like trying to lift it and it's like it's not moving, but it's also not moving inside me either like before. Now, you said sleep paralysis. I've experienced sleep paralysis multiple times and it's nothing. Sleep paralysis is not being like paralyzed. Because I'm paralyzed now and I experience sleep paralysis. Sleep paralysis is like when that hits you, I've had where my a person's right next to me and it's like you're not, it's almost like somebody's on top of you holding you down. And I'll be like I'm not able to breathe or anything. I'm like, oh my gosh, like how can I pull out of this? What you do is you shake your shoulders and then it's like almost shaking a person off of your body. That's exactly what sleep paralysis is like. Like I gotta shake them off. It's like somebody, it feels like somebody is literally holding you down. That's what it feels like. And you're not able to call out. You're not able to talk to tell that person, hey, get this whatever's on me off or something or shake me or something. Yeah. So, but being paralyzed in the beginning was like having this two bodies. So like sometimes you would think like you were moving your left leg and then inside this other like body, it would like would go in and your leg would move, but your leg would still stay there. So it's just like, and then you didn't know how long this was going to be. So you're split on the decision based on movies and TV and stuff that you see, stuff that's not reality a lot of times, you know? And it's just like, so that's how you learned. So you're like, well, I've seen this and the person in the hospital for 6 months, they grow a beard and they shave it and they walk out. No problem. You know? So, I mean, the body takes a hit even to sit up, like you're laying flat to sit up 20 degrees or whatever it is, pass out because your blood pressure drops.
So your whole physiology is reorienting to this. Your mind is reorienting to this and your mindset is reorienting to this. So I'm really, you know, as we start off with all the insane things you're doing today, that even, right, anybody who's doing all the things that you have your hands on still is pretty impressive, even without the circumstances that you went through, and even more so with the circumstances you went through. During this healing process of after this event, what was the time frame where you started adding these things back into your life, where you started making and create, right? So you're a hip hop artist. So like, when did the music start coming back into your life? When did the entrepreneurial side start kicking in? Walk us through kind of like that step by step.
It never left. Everything that was within just got more intense. But it was all about the timing to when that was going to happen. Like the outside world, the naysayer or the people on the outside of me, you're never going to rap again. You're never going to, you know, the never nevers and the can't. So I don't do can't, I do how. Okay. So I didn't know when it was going to be, but it was going to happen. Sometime it would happen. And there were certain things now, but right now I got to survive. So I get out of the hospital and then we go to this place called rehab out in Inglewood, Colorado, Craig Hospital. We went out there because that they specialize in getting you off the ventilator, you know, the life support that I'm on. So that was the goal. The next goal is to breathe again, to do this. That's it. That's the next goal. Just to breathe without a machine. And while you're there, you also go through a lot of different classes like Tetra class where, you know, you said your friend, you know, you learn about your new and your new body, you know, relationships, all that stuff, you know, how to teach someone to care for you. And then while you're there, that's where you just get better. Gradually you get better. You know, eventually I got the halo off and I was able to move my head. I looked like a bobblehead for a while. And then I was able to speak. And then I was able to finally get the ventilator off. Not to mention I was able to sit up in my wheelchair straight up. You just don't sit up in a chair. You pass right out. This is a time frame of 6 months, hospital to to rehab. And then now I'm coming home because I had to be able to sit straight up in an airplane in order to go home without passing out. So you train there. They have like an airplane and a car seat. So you train there on how to get transferred and stuff at Craig Hospital. And then when I come home, you know, it's like I'm at my mom and stepdad's house. Like, what am I going to do? How am I going to work? How am I going to have a family? How am I going to, all these questions, you know, all these questions are going through your head. You just take it, man. You just take it one day at a time. Just take it one day at a time and know what you want in life and know what's going to make you happy and where you want to be back at. And know that it's not going to come overnight. Be patient. Have patience. Have patience. I'm not saying to procrastinate, but patience. You know, wait on patience. Wait that it's going to happen and stick to it. Stay on top of it. Be, you know, stay consistent with it. So, okay, what am I going to do now? Here's my resources. I'm able to find this disability network. Now I'm able to hire my own caregivers. So my life became a business. So I end up jumping in to doing schedules and timesheet or in hours and in hiring process and ads. And then I went back to college. I wanted to just absorb everything, whatever it was. I was going to just take whatever. And Michigan Rehab Services helped with that. At the same time, Mr. Zelli at Disability Network said, you know, get involved, testify with your story. Anytime there's Medicaid cuts or long-term cuts or people with disabilities that are getting pushed to nursing homes and institutions or their hours are getting cut, get involved and go testify. We'll get you there. Okay. So now my advocacy journey is starting. You know, I didn't know what any of this, this is all starting. I'm still 20 years old. And then I tried to go back to the record stuff and I opened up a record business when I learned how to start a business. I got a DBA and then I learned how to incorporate a business. So I did the articles of incorporation because of the internet. Now I got the internet, you know, ding, ding, ding. The internet is right here.
Yep.
And, I wasn't able to afford the assistive technology, like the Dragon and a laptop, but the guy that I worked with, Gus, he provided it for me. And if I bartered to train people on how to do the Dragon, so he trains me how to work the Dragon. I get a laptop and Dragon. And then when he has clients, I go and I train them. So that's how I got my equipment. And then, with the internet, you know, I would look up everything. And then now I'm doing the record company and that, you know, it's everybody want to be superstars. So I just was like, okay, I'm going against the grain. It's hard enough. So I shut that down. And then I started writing from that relationship. A guy in Detroit, Alex, heard about me. He had the promoter newspaper. He wanted me to write a column and sell ads. And so I was like, all right, okay. So I was doing that for five, six years. And I write by voice, you know, I use Dragon naturally speaking. Then he closed the paper down for a while. So then I just checked, I did some mentoring for the state of Michigan, helping people with disabilities find caregivers and have that relationship. And then we lost the grant to that. And then I was on MySpace at the time and I saw Jason and he worked for Live 365. And so I contacted him and he said, yeah. I'm like, how do I get an internet radio station? And he sent over the paperwork and it's called a blanket license. So I was all legit with ASCAP and BMI. And you're talking, this is MySpace. You know, Pandora was around, AOL, Shoutcast.
Napster.
Right. Yeah, all that stuff was around. Yeah. So, and then internet radio was in trouble. And so went to Washington, D.C. with all these guys, like met them there, the CEO of 365 and AOL and Yahoo Shoutcast and Pandora. And we introduced the Internet Radio Equality Act. And then from there, the internet radio was saved for a while. And then loopholes happened and I had to shut mine down. Then I was like, where do I go from here? And that's when I started Easy Awareness by Design. You know, and then from November of the doors opened November 2011, and then 2 years later, the Inspire brand emerges. And, you know, that's the journey. Like, that's the journey and that's the path, you know, and that's just the entrepreneur journey that was still, like I said, like, you know, it was right there inside me and never left. It just got intensified. And there were things that were waiting for me to catch up, whether it be mature enough, mind frame enough, ready for it, not ready for it. Once I got there, I was ready for it, whatever was waiting for me. And then with the music side, the D-Man Foundation, I just happened to be, I was fundraising for a van, you know, and then this girl that I met on a film set, she was like, you know, email this guy, he's my cousin. And he happens to own a home healthcare business and a transportation business. And so we started talking and then he We met March 6, 2010 in person at the Detroit Pistons game. And he said, I'm starting a foundation on the legacy of my brother. His brother passed away August 30th of 2009 from complications of a spinal cord. He was a quadriplegic also. So that's why it's called Danny's D-Man, which stands for Danny's Miracle Angel Network. And so he was telling me, and I was like, I'm down, but I wasn't down from like myself recording, you know, the other clients and stuff that they would end up getting. So once we fundraised for that aspect, we had a lot of fundraisers and committees and boards, and then they opened up the studio, and then I was there one day and they were like, when are you going to record, E? And I'm like, oh yeah, I can do music again. And before you know it, I'm doing music again. And then before you know it, I'm performing on stage 17 years later, you know? So it never left. It just, things went on pause because these are my passions. Mm-hmm. I've had a passion for music since I've been a child, in wordplay, Dr. Seuss, Mother Goose since I've been a baby, hip hop, Run DMC, LL Cool J, you know, Sugar Hill Gang, Beastie Boys, and so many more greats,
sure,
you know, that I can name. So that always stuck with me. Being an entrepreneur since I've been a child, when Nintendo came out, I rented my Nintendo games from the neighborhood kids so that I could use that money and build my Nintendo collection.
Brilliant.
It was a win-win.
Yeah.
And I did other entrepreneur things all the way left, you know, shoveling snow, mowing grass, you know, carrying groceries, whatever it was that I knew the value of a dollar and how to save it for the things that I wanted to buy. You know, it wasn't just given to me. Yes, there was allowance and things like that and cleaning the house, you know. And I lived with my mom because my mom was divorced. So I lived with her. And, you know, just those things never left. And both of my parents, they're hard workers. So I saw their work ethic and their grind. So it's always just been there. You know, I think they say you leave the place better than what you found it. I think that's the saying. And if you have some elbow grease, you got time to lean, you got time to clean. So those are things that follow me, you know. So it never, it didn't go away. It was there. It was just waiting. It was just intensified. A lot of times people get into trauma, mm-hmm, and they go the opposite. You know, and
yeah,
me, I think it just brought it out more, even though I'm not able to move from the neck down. But what was inside me, man, which came out like a lion roaring, you know, just roar, you know, and it was like, and it's like, I'm just on this journey, and this, I got more dreams and more goals, you know, just to achieve. And I just, and you know what? And also a lot of the stuff I do helps other people.
For sure.
So it's a service. I always am trying to help somebody's quality of life, you know, someone get a wheelchair van, or someone fundraise for assistive technology, or someone find a caregiver, or someone that is just not dealing with things right, but it's not able to deal with things right now and they're in isolation. So reach out to me. Yeah, man, let's talk or something. So a lot of the things that I went from at that time, a hip hop stage, to performing on a different stage is the stage of helping people with disabilities, making sure things are accessible, making sure we have representation. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of things that came out of that was amazing from the shooting. Mm-hmm. It's an unfortunate matter that you got to go through it, and it's painful. I'm not saying I just spent 820 days on bed rest from complications of a bone infection. So I'm not saying it's easy. It is not the only challenges, but there are happier moments than that outweigh any of the other stuff. Yeah. I say like this, I got good days and better days. So.
Sure. Yeah. And as I'm sitting here thinking of like anybody who goes through anything, right? Me being a therapist and my job is to inspire a way of getting them to the other side of the mountain, to realize that the mountain shouldn't be what we're focusing on, but what's life going to be like from the other side, right? And put more time and attention and effort into that than talking about what's there blocking them. But we all have our crappy days. We all have our stuff that we have to work on. We all have challenges and tribulations in our own right, and the whole thing of like, how do we compare one person's personal journey to another personal journey? Mm-hmm. But I also know that we have to look to other people to inspire us, that,
yeah,
right, have a different set of circumstances that put things into context. And in that light, saying, okay, if they can do it, I can do it.
Yeah.
Right. Where have you seen in some of your awesome stories of connecting with people and bringing advocacy to the world and to the government? Is there a story or an anecdote or two that you can share where someone was just like, if you know, where you were able to be involved, where someone in your community was able to be involved and it got someone from point A to point B that the inspire mindset really did kick in for them?
I would say that there's multiple stories. I don't know if it was the inspire mindset or if it was the mentoring mindset.
Yeah.
Like me helping them and not right. doing it
well,
for
I
them.
See those as the same. Those are all you,
okay,
right?
Okay,
so
yeah.
So yeah. I'm seeing like right there. Yeah. Yeah. You're the brand,
it could be,
right?
yes. And it could be just different things like that they were just trying to, that they were stuck. You know, they didn't know what they wanted with life. You know, there's like certain kind of tools I've used, like, okay, let's meet up. Tell me what your best day looks like. You know, like, what does it look like? Write it out or type it out or have someone write it for you or, you know, transcribe it. What does it look like? You know, how does it look? Where would you be? What would you be doing? Who would be there? Like, what would you be eating, drinking? What type of climate would it be? What would be your careers and hobbies? And then make that best day happen. Now write your how. How can you make that day happen? You know, and then there were some times where I would tell somebody that and they would say, well, I want to work at Red Lobster. And that's, I'm like, whoa, like, I'm not limited. Like, there's no limit to this. Like, okay, let me give you an example, you know, and I'd give them an example. And they were like, but that's not possible. I'm like, anything, it's all possible. You know, they were so limited on thinking that just the best day of their life was just working for Red Lobster. And I'm like, I wanted them to think bigger, think with no limits, you know, no limit. Don't limit yourself on this thought process. Just write it out. You know, they're like, well, can I put this? I'm like, yeah, it's yours. Put whatever you want. You know, if you decide that you think you want to live on another planet, put it, you know, just whatever. You know, I mean, there's going to be other things that you're going, it's going to help your thought process open up your mind to start really thinking big. And then maybe that part, another planet at the moment, is not, but there's things that you start seeing as you're writing, you know, that you start, wow, start to think about and stuff. You know, the other thing is like, how, you know, who's toxic? Think about the pros and cons of the people you're around. You know, what are they really? How are they helping? You know, is this person like, what have, you know, do they check on you? Are they very toxic with you? Are they naysayers? Do they just, you know, always make you feel bad? You know, start thinking about that too. You know, those, your circle of supports, you want to build your circle. So those are just like little stories with other people, you know, and it's not just like one thing. I've also had where someone was not doing well in life, maybe even, you know, to commit suicide. And they're like, you know, what you said just changed my life. You're like, wow, what did I say? You know, or what was it? What was that? That's why it's so important to share your story, because you never know how bad someone's having it, you know, and why, like, just the words that you say or just showing up can save a person's life. There's probably people you have no idea the lives that you have affected in a real positive way, but somewhere you know that if you stick, you know, with the same mission and the same person, be authentic, mm-hmm. be truthful, be transparent, be you. You know, show them that you can be you, because I run into a lot of people and they're like, well, you like this person. I like this person. You think I should be more like this person or more like this person? I'm like, who are you? Like, be you. What do you mean? Be you. Be you. If you're an artist, figure out your craft, figure out your flow, figure out what works for you. Because when you try to be all these other people, that's hard to hold up. That's a lot of work. That's a lot of mental weight, you know, to try to be like somebody else and then go on Instagram and take all these pictures and it's all highlights. You're not showing me any balance. Where's your days that aren't so like this? You know, where's the blemishes in your face or something? Where's the pimple? Where's the outfit?
Or where's the rawness, right? Where's the real deal? And I see that all the time, especially in that entrepreneur space. It's like, I was talking to a buddy of mine who, we've been really nailing down Clubhouse, the new app, right? That everybody's been,
trying to get me on it.
Yeah. So let's go. Are you on iPhone or an Android?
I have an Android.
That's why. Right. Yeah. Got to get an iPad or something. We'll get you on. I'll get you. So we are talking about the idea that like, you can't fake it on there, right? People either are going to hear that you know what you're talking about or you're not going to know what you're talking about. And you're going to have proof in the pudding, right? You can't just post something on Instagram or social or TikTok or whatever and just like rant a limbo, right? You can't do that in these things. And I think like the authenticity, right? Inspiration through authenticity is what we really have at the end of the day. Like, I'm a marriage and family therapist who comes from I'm a child of my parents are divorced 10 years ago. I got divorced when I was just starting out, you know, being a therapist. And so what does that mean? Like, oh, I shouldn't be doing couples counseling. I'm actually really good at couples counseling, right? And I use that of like, let me help you not get stuck where me and 54%, if not more at this point, of the country got. But I can see it from the inside vantage point of like, oh, I recognize that pattern. Don't do that, right? It's not just the textbook. I can also see it in real deal, you know, live pay-per-view, you know, action. Yeah. So even though I don't just see couples, but I see, you know, 50% of my week is probably couples at this point. But it's bringing that vulnerable to the stage of whatever we're doing of, yeah, like I struggled through this and here's what I learned. Here's the teachable moment. I think is really what I'm, you know, thinking about being inspiring and inspiring others is, you know, what's your teachable moment? What did you learn from the difficulties that you went through? And if you didn't learn anything from it, then it was a massively wasted opportunity.
Yeah. Just like failure. You know, I call failure growth spurts. And when I meet people, they say that they've never failed. I'm like, whoa, I'm like, go way over there.
Right.
There's no way because
you're full of crap. Yeah.
Right. You have to fail. Like I'd say it's tough in you. You're going to grow from failure because you're not going to do it again. Hopefully you might repeat it. I've repeated that but some things more than once, but you're supposed to, what do they say? You knew better, you do better. So it's like, you do it. You have to face the customer and tell them their order is not ready on the deadline. What do? You know, you just got to make it right. Somehow you don't give them excuses.
Right.
Just face the music, you know, and tell them. It's not ready.
Right. Well, and even if you call out, right, if you call out what you think they're going to feel, right, in that situation, right, this, it's always the scripting. It's always the, how do I pull the carpet out from under them in a way that supports them, right? That yanking the tablecloth out, right? And you know, in that situation, it's like, I know what I'm about to say. I had this with a client a few weeks ago, and I love push, like my clients know that like we can get playful with each other and it's a safe space to like, you know, drop the F-bomb and whatever it is. And I'm like, all right, so I'm about to share something with you, but I want you to get your middle finger ready to flip me off after I say this to you. Yeah. You know, like, no, I would never do that. I'm like, yeah, that's fine. I know you might never do it, but I'm just going to give you permission. You might not like what I'm about to say to you, but I'm saying it from love.
Yeah.
And you might want to tell me to go F off. And I said something to him that I called him out on, something like, this is what it seems like. This is what I'm hearing. Is it possible that this is what could be happening or how you're coming across to someone? And it didn't sit well with them because it just was a smack in the face, so to speak, of what they were not able to see. And they're like, you're right. I do want to flick you off right now.
Yeah.
So, I'm like, good. Like, so like, but I diffused it before it happened because I called out what might happen for them. Right. And right. I think that's like part of the growth process is that you might feel depressed. You might feel disappointed. You might feel like you're never going to accomplish it, but guess what? There's going to be that crack in the armor. There's going to be some light that's going to come in and it's going to start happening.
Yeah. That door is going to open just a little crease.
Right.
Just a little glimmer of light's going to come through it. And you're going to be like, there it is, you know, kick it down.
Right.
Now go there and blast that door open because it's open now, you know? Yes.
Well, and a lot of people don't know what to do once that door is open. They're so used to the struggle. They're still right. They're so used to the fight. They're so used to like, I need to have some type of conflict in my life that they don't know how to lean into the pleasantness of that journey of enjoying and appreciating all of that hard work as well. So that, you know, I do want to see people find a way.
That's
to
kind of like,
that.
The guy I met, I spoke somewhere, Philip Zen starts with a Z. He created this like test where he took the school and he had some people act like they were prisoners and some people act like that they were correctional officers. And he said that they could leave anytime. So this is the guy that created this experiment. He was telling me about it. He said that they could leave anytime. They just had to act. So the correctional officers had to act like they were, you know, and the prisoners had to act like they were. And at one time, they were able to leave and they were still in prison. Like, they were still felt like...
Right, I mean, they bought still, into that role and they bought into that...
Yeah, the mind.
Experience,
Like, yeah, the trauma or the mindset that set in. And the other thing that was interesting is he said that they started taking on the character roles. And, like, he had to shut it down because I guess it got, like, really out of control. You know, I'm trying to think what school it was, what college that was.
Yeah, I can't remember. Yeah, it's a famous, right? It's a social psychology study, right? And it is, right? We get stuck in our story so much that we then become a victim to that story. And then we find experiences that just justify us staying stuck. Or as the late, great psychologist Kurt Cobain used to say, I like the comfort in being sad.
Yeah.
Right? There is that becomes our baseline. And anything from that baseline becomes incredibly difficult, even though if it doesn't serve us in the end.
Right. And that's the thing. Like, a person can be able to move their arms and legs. There is stuff in this world that's out there that will completely just paralyze their momentum.
Yeah.
Their action, you know, being able to take actionable steps, like just them, like whatever it is within. So if the door opened, they would still sit in the room. Like, well, because that's what they tried so hard for like 50 days straight. They tried to open the door. They tried to push it. They tried to explode it. They tried to, you know, they tried to scratch it. They tried to call out. They tried to, you know, they tried to walk around it. They tried to do like, you know, spin and maybe do like what a video game does. They played the magic flute and the door went open and they were still there trying to get this door open. And then all one day the door opened and the person just sat in the room and didn't even go. And that's the thing, what happens with fear, with depression, mm-hmm. with isolation, mm-hmm. and things like that. And so that's the other thing. When I come across some people, I have to work through that first. You know, I have to work through that because that's like a trauma, you know, what's been happening. So you have to work through that. Some people you don't, but some people you do, you know. And then once you finally just get that breakthrough, this is another story, but you've just gotten through that breakthrough of just like the isolation trauma or the depression trauma, where they're like, they start feeling better about themselves. They start loving themselves, I guess you would say, because whatever happened in the past, bullying, they said that they didn't look good. They don't even feel beautiful. They don't even feel like they're actually a handsome or beautiful person. You know, they feel like they're not worthy or their self. Like, those are some of the things that I've, you know, people I've talked to, and I'm like, no, like, you gotta like get up and be like, look, just write down the things you want to achieve and accomplish. Yeah, but how am I going to do it? I'm not able to do that. I can't do that. I can't do that. I'm like, yeah, because you keep saying I can't. Sure. Let's change this wording. Let's just change. Let's write down what you really want to do and what makes you happy. And then just instead of saying you can't, just say, how can I make that happen? You know, and then let's just keep working on that. So every day, you just look at what you want to achieve and say, I want to, you know, own a business. And it's this, how am I going to do that? How am I going to own a business? I'm going, and then start changing it and say, I'm a business owner. Like, it's already happened.
Sure.
You know, today.
Well, that changes your neural pathways. And the other question I would ask in there is, with who? Who's going to help me? Who can I partner with? Who's an expert in this area? Who can I brainstorm with? Who can, right? Who has the area of expertise about that I don't, so that I can leverage that out, right?
Right. And that's where when you start putting your how, then you put your who. But then I always tell them, why are you doing it? Why do you want to do this? What is your why? Like, why do you want vanity? Do you want celebrity? Do you want to be a celebrity? Do you want like this Hollywood lifestyle? Do you understand what that stuff's really like? You know, like, why is it? Because I want people to like me. Unless, you don't have to go about that just to get people to like you.
Right. And it's never going to be enough if you don't like yourself. Never. No matter how many, right? The whole world.
Themselves.
Right. Which will never happen. Yeah.
Yeah. The whole world could like you. Like you said, 699 billion people could like you. But if you don't love yourself,
you ain't going to feel
it. You'll never feel it.
Yeah.
You'll never feel it. Wow, what a beautiful moment.
Yeah, right. And that's where I think like that inspire from within is really such a powerful, you know, you got to inspire yourself and be around the right people and the right mindset and the right. You said, you talked about toxic energy before and toxic people. And, you know, we're in a world of chaos right now, right? We got something that's toxic that's attacking all of our, you know, that's a risk of attacking our bodies in this pandemic. And we have toxic politics and people, right, really just not liking people anymore. And it's really, 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 really challenging to find something that's inspiring when there's chaos all around it. And we do have to dig deep. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so thankful to have my podcast, because I joke that at the end of the day, it's truly a selfish play for me. This is purely to get me in front of people that inspire me, that motivate me, that get me some information that I never would have figured out myself, and to use it as a little bit of a selfish resource. But I am, obviously, I want to share it to my community and to my people, and I want people to get tons of right tremendous resources about this and find some inspiration and some motivation for themselves. But this became therapeutic for me.
Yeah.
as well, right? So there's so many ways of doing this. And I want people to know, like, while they're listening, like, there's no excuse except for the excuses that you create for yourself. And that's why I wanted to add that with who. Who's going to help me get there, right? I don't need to know. I always ask my clients, what's your dream team? And you don't need to know them in person, and you don't need to be able to afford them. But who's your dream team? Who would you want in your life to help get you to where you want to be? I'm like, oh, I would love Tony Robbins, but I can't afford to go to his conference. I'm like, well, isn't there, like, I don't know, 800,000 hours of Tony Robbins on YouTube right now, right? Have you gone through 10 hours? Right. Have you gone through 10 hours? No, I haven't. I'm like, oh, well.
So they only went through an hour.
Right. So you're full of crap.
They just see him. See him, and they just want to put him on the dream team. But you've never even taken the time to invest your time to invest in him. Mm-hmm. So why would he come and just jump on your team if you haven't even invested time to watch him?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or share a post of his. He's having a challenge class, or he's having
whatever it is, a speaking
event. Uh-huh. Right.
Yeah. Like, but I was just saying, even just like the basic consumable of like, just get data in front of you, just get information in front of you, right? Have you listened to a podcast episode? Have you listened? And there's so many times I see this with my couples, or clients, like, oh, how many, it's like, so you want this like really quick fix for your relationship. Okay. How many books on relationships have you read? Zero. Okay. How many YouTube videos have you watched on relationship dynamics, right? Zero. Okay. Podcasts? No. Talks with a spiritual leader, a mentor, a family of someone in that you know that you have that has a relationship that you're trying to emulate? None. I'm like, okay, but yet you want us to fix it in the next 4 weeks, right? These are the things that are all mindset that are easily fixable. And I want to challenge people who are listening to this episode that we got to get our mindset right. We have to first start understanding what's the phrasing and the sayings that we're saying that are keeping us limited in getting what we want. And once we re-language that, once we re-script that, then all the things are going to start showing up for us in the way that we want to get it. And I think that's what the inspiration is for me as I'm listening to you, is like, we got to inspire ourselves.
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely change the word, the mindsets, like you said.
Exactly.
And if you don't know how to pay attention to other people, they're taking words and they're just changing one word, but it changes the whole outcome, the whole mindset, the whole
life.
You're right. Like the four agreements. Wow. Yeah. That book.
Love
right
that book.
There, just those four agreements. Right. Or just if somebody just follows those four agreements, that's just one agreement would change their life. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's this, be impeccable with your word, don't make assumptions.
Right.
Don't
being impeccable to your word is not just about what you're saying out into the world about other people. It's also what you're saying about yourself. Don't crap talk yourself. Don't shit talk yourself.
Yeah.
Right. Don't beat yourself up. Don't like, and it comes so naturally. I remember a few months ago, I think it was before the pandemic, and I had a great day at my office and I had amazing clients and I love my clients. And I came home and I'm like walking into my condo and I'm like, oh God, you did crap today. Like, what are you doing being a therapist? I'm like, where did that come from? Whose voice is that? Like, whoa, like, I had a great day. No, you did crap today. You didn't do anything for anybody. I'm like, that's not me. That's not my own voice. Like, where is that negative? So, like, we have to first catch that and, like, really not get into that. So I know that there's probably so much more we can get into and, And I want to lead people directly to all the things that are going on in your world. So number one, if you have been listening to this episode and you haven't yet gone on Instagram to follow Eric, please, please, please do so. It's Eric with a C, Patrick Thomas. And you can check out also at Inspire Shirt One, at D-Man Foundation, and Easy Awareness. Those are all of the things that he has his hands in, and he's thriving after injury, entrepreneur, inspirational speaker, advocate, hip-hop artist. Dude, Eric, thank you so much. This was like just the motivation that we need right now, the inspiration we need right now to just wake up in the morning, have your cup of coffee, and then go inspire. As one of your mugs says, guys, if you also like, he has this awesome, awesome stuff on his website. He's got t-shirts and accessories and like just little mindset, little awesomenesses that just get you going. If you're watching the YouTube video version of this, he's got this sick, sick Inspire hat that you can pick up for yourself. If you want to put some positivity in front of yourself, go support Eric and his Easy Awareness. It's easyawareness.com. And Eric, man, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. It was great. We knew we were going to have some fun and we were able to really bring out some really good, tools. Or they call, I don't know what, they always call them the nuggets, but we'll call them the mindset growth tools or something. Yeah. We got to rename it. We got to figure out a really good name.
We got to come up with something. We got to come up with something.
A takeaway.
Yeah. So here's my last question for you. And I didn't even prepare you for this last question. Can you throw down some bars?
Oh yeah. I mean, you know, I've, one of the songs I have, which is interesting, it's called Beat My Belly Like a Bongo. And it's, it happened because I was eating food and people watching. That's what I do before I was going into my shop. And Jesse was brushing the food off my stomach and it sounded like a bongo. So I was like, wow, beat my belly, bongo, bongo, my belly, bongo, belly, bongo. And then that was a Wednesday. And then Saturday, Bangtown called me up and he's a producer, engineer. And he was like, hey, I got time to do some recording. Want me to come over? And I was like, yeah. Then he came over. I wanted to work with him forever. He's awesome. You know, he's one of the best. And then he said, you got a song concept? And I'm like, well, I got this in my head that's like, beat my belly like a bongo. And I just told him, I was like, beat my belly like a bongo, beat my belly like a bongo, you know. And then he started hitting the kick drum and, you know, and then we started playing the beat. I'm like, yeah, that's how I hear it. And then I started writing, and then I did the lyrics freestyle. You know, first it was beat my belly like a bongo, beat my belly like a bongo, beat my belly like a bongo, my belly, my belly, my belly. And then I said, my belly feeling empty, searching for the music, good and plenty, revving up, are you ready? Swift and puff, I'm rolling heavy, my ride is wheelchair ready, here's the Chevy, mozzarella, happy days, bonzarelli, feeling like my birthday, funfetti, beat my belly like a bongo, beat my belly like a bongo. And the way I did it is each bar I would say, and then I would go back and say it, and then I would write it in my head, and then go back and then beat my belly like a bongo, my belly, my belly, my belly. Call me the music man, 76 trombones and a boy's plan. Here's the plan. Oh yeah, Sugar Hill and my Kool-Aid man. Transform superhuman, macho man. Spaghetti, yo, macaroni and cheese. Run DMCs and the boys get beasty. Trained in the basement, it was gritty. Beat street, rap city. Bring me back the old TV raps. Words like psych and who's the Mac? Bob Ross, we need you, man. We have trees in the Flint land. Beat my belly like a bongo. 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 My belly, my belly, my belly. Beat my belly like a bongo. 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 4, 3, 2, 1. Everybody play your belly jumps. Come on. Boom, 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 boom. So yeah, that's how.
That's awesome.
It was awesome. Yeah. If you go to Google and just type in beat my belly like a bongo, I am the only person out there with that song. So that's the cool thing. Nobody else will show up right. But me.
And you're having fun while you're doing this, which is even better, right? If you're bringing your love to your craft.
Yeah, I love it. I enjoy it. I'm not here to impress the world. I'm just here to make it feel like I love what it does. Some people like it. Some people don't. Some people might say it's cliche or whatever. That's fine. That's cool. That's their opinion. But I like it. I love it. I like what it is. I like what I do. You know, I did a song that I paid homage to Dr. Seuss. Remember Green Eggs and Ham? Mm-hmm. I called it EIB, basically Eric, you know, EIB instead of Sam, I am EIB. And it's called, Do You Like Hip Hop MCs? And he's like, do you like hip hop MCs? I'm like, I do not like them. EIB. Do you like hip hop MC? I do not like them. EIB. And then I was able to go into like, you know, would you listen to them here or there? Would you listen to them anywhere? Would you listen to them with a tiny mouse? Would you listen to them in a square house? Would you listen to them riding red tractor? Would you listen to them Velociraptor? Would you listen to them in a big brown box? Would you listen to them playing with Lego blocks? And then it goes back and he's like, I would not listen to them with playing with Lego blocks. Would not listen to them in a big brown box. I would not listen to them with a Velociraptor. Would not listen to them riding a red tractor. Would not listen to them in a tiny or in a square house. Would not listen to them with a tiny mouse. Would not listen to them here or there. I would not listen to them anywhere. And then it's like, do you like hip hop MCs? I do not like them. EIB. So it was just like, it was, and I played every part. Incredible. So I played the protagonist, antagonist, and I played the atlas, like the thing. Yeah, and it was weird in the studio because I was hearing myself and then I had to change my voice and everything. And it was
sweet.
It was a fun song though. I just, you know,
yeah,
just have fun.
Have
if I can leave anything. Fun. Yeah, if I can leave anything with this, you know, it's like, if you're listening, just have fun with life. Find the happiness, man. Just enjoy it and don't. Like you said earlier, don't beat yourself up. And I've been watched on Netflix and then I get off it and I'm like, what did I just do?
Right.
I got dreams to achieve.
Go? Right. What did I just, where'd that time just go? What did I just watch that crap for? Right. Exactly.
I know. Exactly. And maybe you do need to kick your butt a little bit.
Exactly. And if anybody out there is struggling with a little bit of mindset and needs some butt kicking, get yourself in front of Eric. Reach out to him on Instagram. Hit him up on a DM. And bring him into your world. If you're looking for speakers for your next event, if you're looking just connect with Eric again. It's Eric, E-R-I-C, Patrick Thomas on Instagram. And easyawareness.com is his website. Eric, my man. Looking forward to staying in touch and hearing more and more.
Most definitely.
More of you thriving.
Yeah.
All right, brother. Thanks for hanging out.
I'm looking forward to staying in touch. Hanging out, message me, let me know. All right, peace.